Amen and amen. I am thankful that you are here tonight. I hope that you've come with a heart ready to worship and adore our blessed Savior. As you well know, tonight is a special night. Brother Kenny, Dr. Kenny Digby, will be sharing God's word with us. You heard him last February, and you were blessed, and I was blessed. And so Dr. Digby, is so good to have you back with us. Let me give you just a couple quick announcements, if I can. First and most importantly, don't forget Thursday night our association will be having the evangelism training. We do it every year. Dr. Sean Parker will be with us sharing a message, and then we'll have 8 different breakout sessions for you to choose from. If you want to ride in one of the vans, be here by 6 o'clock, or you can go to North Columbia yourself at 6:30 is when it will kick off. So keep that in mind. Also, those that's planning on going on the Knoxville mission trip, need you here at 4 o'clock next Sunday. So don't forget that. Those that's going on the mission trip, please be in the fellowship hall at 4 o'clock. Also, next Sunday night, Dr. Don Lum will be with us sharing God's word, so you pray for him. At this time, we're going to pause and dedicate this service to the Lord. Let's pray. King Jesus, thank you so much for this day, this opportunity to be in your house. Lord, I pray that you'd bless this moment, bless this time. Lord, thank you for Dr. Digby, what he's meant in my life throughout the years. I pray that you'd bless him indeed. Use him, Father. And Lord, I also pray for my brother, Caleb, that you'd be with him. Thank you, Lord, for his ministry here at your church. And Father, in all things, may we, your people, rejoice. And Lord, may we serve you with all that we are and all that we have. Lord Jesus, bless this time that we have together. It's in the sweet name of Jesus we pray. Amen and amen.
Well, good evening. If you will, I'll invite you to stand for this opening hymn. We're going to start with number 149, Praise Him, Praise Him. Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. What a way to start a service just by praising God. That's what we're here for, right?
Praise Him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, His wonderful love proclaim. Hail Him, highest archangels sing glory.
Deep and strong. Praise Him, praise Him.
Sing number 111, The Love of God. There's nothing like the love of God. Another thing on this song that I don't know how many of you know, but this the third verse, we're going to sing the first and third verses, so that's a little cue for the guys up top there. Sometimes I tell them what I'm doing, and sometimes I don't, so if y'all see something come flying across here one day, you'll know why, because sometimes my communication don't work too good. But the last verse here, this is beautiful. It says, could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made? Now, those of you that don't know this, this song was written, or they found the third stanza of this song pinned on the wall in an insane asylum. Someone who was supposedly mentally incapable. I don't know how you say that, but okay. Didn't know all of what was going on around him, but was able to write these beautiful words, pin this on there. I think this was a saved person. They may have got some things mixed up in their mind while they're here on this earth, but their affections, their minds, their heart, their things were not set on this earth. They were set on the things above, and I believe deep down inside, somewhere in their life, they had made peace with Jesus. They knew that he was their Savior and their God. Could we with ink the oceans fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the oceans dry, nor could a scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. You have to know the love of God to be able to pen something so wonderful. We're going to sing about the love of God. He is a loving God. He is a merciful God. You know, we don't often speak of the wrath of God. He is also a wrathful God. But thank God that he is a loving God, that he has had mercy and grace on us. So let's sing number 111, The Love of God.
The love of God is great. Child, he reckons.
506, in Christ alone, my hope is found. If it's not for the love of Christ, I couldn't tell you where I would be today if it wasn't for what he has done and what he has supplied and the way he's paid for us today. Stand, if you will. We're going to sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. This will be our offertory hymn. I want
Lord, we just ask you to be with Brother Digby tonight, Lord. Dear Lord, just help us hear the message that you laid upon his heart, Lord. And most important, help each one of us go out and live that message, Lord. In Jesus' name, I pray.
Thank you.
Before Caleb comes and shares a message and song with us, I want to pause and introduce our guest preacher tonight, Dr. Kenny Digby. He's always been special to me, and he probably knows what I'm about to say. 3 years ago, or this in July, it'll be 3 years, probably one of the best revival service, if not the best revival service I've ever been a part of, took place between him and my music minister, which was Brother Bobby Whittington. But we didn't know exactly what was going on, why God moved in such a way, but it was just a blessed week. You know, there's sometimes it was just like you couldn't walk through the doors without experiencing the Lord and Bobby and Brother Kenny, and it was just wonderful. But of all the things, I say that to tell you this, the revival started on Sunday morning, went through Wednesday, and we really even thought about extending it because God was just everywhere, Doug. We didn't. That Thursday, we had a men's meeting together, and Brother Bobby and all of us was there. Friday morning, Brother Bobby went to go fishing and got to see Jesus. But I said that to tell you this, to give you an idea what type of man Brother Kenny is, Dr. Kenny. He had found out that Bobby had passed away, and the man came, and I will never forget that, Kenny. I'll never forget. He was there, and I saw him when he hugged on Brenda, told her how he loved her. He prayed with her, and I'm going to tell you guys, he's the real deal. And so, Brother Digby, here in just a minute, when Caleb is through, I want you to come and you share what God has placed upon your heart. Thank you for being the man you are.
Sing a song that I thought go along with some of the, you know, what we've sang so far. Talked about, you know, his amazing grace, that last song we did, and I've already mentioned his mercy, and that's what we're going to try to sing. One of my favorite songs, and I hope it'll bless you tonight. It's called Mercy Walked In. I stood in the courtroom. Judge turned my way. It looks like you're guilty. Now what do you say? I spoke up, Your Honor. I have no defense. But that's when mercy walked in. Mercy walked in and pleaded my case, called to the stand, God's saving grace. The blood was presented that comes. Stood there and wonder, how could this be, that someone so guilty had just been set free? My chains were broken, and I felt born again. The moment that mercy walked in, oh, mercy walked in and pleaded my case, called to the stand, God's saving grace, the blood was presented that covered my sin, forgiven when mercy walked in. The blood
presented that covered my sin. Forgiven when mercy walked in.
Turning your Bibles with me, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I'm going to read those first four verses in just a moment. Caleb, Sarah, where are you? Thank you. Man, that was good. Thank you, Bunker Hill. It's good to be back. I enjoyed being with you last year, and I have looked forward to this occasion. Thank you. Brother Gary, your sweet wife, thank y'all. I will be at Blue Mountain tomorrow. And I had to rub that in a little with Brother Gary a while ago, but... it's just wonderful to be with you. My wife, Becky, raise your hand, Becky, is with me. And that is such a blessing for her to get in and come down with me. And so we are just glad to be here. I'm excited. Your speakers, Kenny, last Sunday night, and... Don Lum and your other speakers that'll be coming in here. My, what a blessing. So thank you, thank you, thank you. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, look at verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Big Daddy Weave has a hit song. Becky and I love it. She pointed it out to me. Heaven changes everything. If you haven't heard it, I'd encourage you to go listen to it. Heaven changes everything. But what I want to share with y'all tonight, in reality, it's the gospel that changes everything. There would be no heaven without the gospel. There would be no blessed hope. There would be no looking forward for Becky and me to see our son, Austin. The gospel changes everything. Now, what is the gospel? And I don't mean to be nitpicky, But we do need to be accurate. I love Christmas. I can't wait for Christmas. It's one of my favorite times of the year. The incarnation. The fact that God became man in the womb of Mary. Woo! That is something. But the birth of Jesus, according to Paul now, the birth of Jesus is not part of the gospel. I love teaching the end times. I get to do that pretty often. I'll be doing it in a week or two at a church, then about a month later, where we get to dig into the tribulation and the millennium and the two battles and the three judgments. I love that. And part of the reason I love it is because my daddy, Eugene Digby, he discipled me, and most of what I know on Revelation, he taught it to me, and I just enjoy going back through it. But as much as I love the end times, eschatology, the second coming of Jesus is not, according to Paul, part of the gospel. If you've still got your Bibles open, 1 Corinthians 15, look at verse 3 and 4. According to Paul, the gospel is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, it's sort of interesting to me. I've been preaching 54 years. I've heard a bunch of preaching. And a lot of good preachers treat the gospel as if it's a duet. They've got a lot to say about the death of Jesus, his shed blood, there on Golgotha's hill, and rightfully so. They have a lot to say about the resurrection. And that's very, very important. But you don't hear a lot about the burial. And I'm going to tell you again, the gospel is not a duet. Brother Caleb and his sweet wife, that was some duet a while ago. But the gospel is not a duet. The gospel is a trio. The gospel is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. Now, we're going to look at it for the next few moments. The kind of test in school I despised was essay. You know where the teacher would put three questions on the blackboard and they expected you to write a book? I might ought to dedicate this part of the sermon to Dr. Ronald Meeks, my best friend. I didn't like that kind of test when I was a student, and I sure didn't like that kind of test when I was a professor. I didn't want to sit at my desk for hours and hours and hours reading subjective answers. I enjoyed fill in the blank. That's okay. I liked, give me six reasons. Give me seven qualities. Give me eight. I liked that kind. But now, let me tell you, my favorite kind of test. Anybody want to take a guess? What do you think might have been my both given and taken? Anybody want to take a guess what my favorite kind of test was? Matching. You see, matching, if you get started correctly, it gets easier the farther you go. Y'all remember matching test? So for the next few moments, we're going to do a matching test. Brother Gary, if we was over in the fellowship hall, small groups, I'd ask you to take out a piece of paper and a pen, and I'd make you actually match this up. But since we're in the auditorium, then I'll match it up for you. What's the gospel? Number one, the death of Jesus on Calvary's cross. Number two, the burial of Jesus in Joseph's new tomb. Number three, the resurrection of Jesus on the third day, the first day of the week. Now you got it? Number one is death. Number two is burial. Number three is resurrection. Over here, past, present, and future. A, your past. B, your present. C, your future. The gospel changes everything. Now, without fudging, you got to make a decision. Does his death change my past more? Change my present more? Or change my future? And you got to pick one. Now, I'll go ahead and warn you. Becky says, why do you ask questions? You don't take nobody's answer but yours. Listen to me. Number one, his death on that cross changed my future. I will not be at the great white throne judgment. I will not be cast into a lake of fire and brimstone. I've got a home in heaven. Amen. If I died right now, you remember when we had asked that? If you died right now, do you know where you'd go? If you died, sister, right now, do you know where you'd go? I'm here to tell you, because of, number one, because of his death, he forever, he changed, see, he changed my future. I don't deserve it. I didn't earn it. I didn't live good enough to get it. All my righteousness is a filthy rag. I'm here to tell you, Brother Caleb, mercy walked in. And because of his mercy and His grace and His love. I've got a home in heaven. It ain't hope so, think so, maybe so. I'm here to tell you, I know I've got a home in heaven. 1 John, these things have been written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know. So the gospel changes everything. The gospel changes my future. His death changes my future. Well, I told you, if you get started right on a matching test, it gets easier. And since this is my test, we got started right. His burial. And again, I'm repetitive. A lot of folks, they don't even like the burial is part of the gospel. It is a huge part of the gospel. His burial covers my past. When they buried him, they buried him out of sight. And I'm here to tell you, once we get saved, our past is gone. Do you understand that? Your past is gone. The Bible says He cast all your sin into a sea of forgetfulness, and then He put up a no fishing sign. Don't y'all believe that? All your sin. You say, now, Brother Kenny, yeah, all my sin before I got saved, I hope not, or you're going to hell. Are you listening to me? Thank you. Ain't that a blessing? Listen to me. When He died on the cross, all your sin was in the future. And when He died on the cross, He took all your sin and nailed it to that cross. And then He stamped it, tetelestai, paid in full. Our sin is gone. You know the problem here? We got a bunch of Baptists. God's forgiven you. You haven't forgiven yourself. Think about that now. God has forgiven you. Quit cringing. You say, oh, but I look back at what I did and, oh, God has forgiven you. Your sin is as far as not the north to the south. My daddy used to point this out, that when you leave the North Pole, you're headed south. When you cross the South Pole, you're back headed north. He didn't put our sin as far as the north is from the south. That's a limited distance. But you can keep going east forever. Or you can keep going west forever. Our sin is as far as the east from the west. I'm just telling you, His burial is important. For surely as He was buried and out of sight, your sin has been buried, and it is out of sight. That's why we baptize. When we baptize, we're picturing death, burial, resurrection, but we're also telling everybody, this young man, this young lady, she or he, they have died to their old way of life, and they've been buried, and they are what? Brought up in newness of life. I'm going to say it again. If God can forgive you, you need to forgive yourself. Woo! So his death changed my future. His burial covered my past. Number three, his resurrection charges my present. Somebody says, how can you live the victorious Christian life in such a wicked, wicked, wicked world today? How can that teenager, with all that they're facing, how can that teenager, sold out, dedicated, born again, how can they live in today's world? How can a granddaddy or grandmother live the Christian life in today's world? I'll tell you, we have the resurrected Lord living in us. It's called incarnational Christianity. Christ in you, the hope of glory. His resurrection, he ain't dead. Amen? He ain't dead. He's alive. And if you're saved, he lives in you. We have the dynamite of the resurrection within us. We have the power of the resurrection. I can do all things through Christ who lives in me. I went to Guatemala, born once, preaching with a translator, which I like, because when you're preaching with a translator, and I'm not a hiccup preacher, I'm not being ugly, I'm just being descriptive. And while I'm thinking through my next saying, they're translating, so I like preaching with the translator. I'm in a church in Guatemala City, packed out, hanging from the chandeliers. I'm preaching. My dear friend Jorge Martinez is a great translator. He's translated for me many a time. I'm over here waxing eloquent, or at least the best I can. And I'm looking out at this crowd saying, how can you overcome temptation? You can't. How can you quit alcohol? You can't. How can you get off those drugs? You can't. And it got quiet over here. He quit translating. I mean, you get used to hearing that echo. And it got quiet. So I turn and I look at him, and he's got this painful look on his face. Near like he's fixing to cry. He loved me. We were friends. But he had quit me. I said, Jorge, Translate. He said, no. Yeah, I need you. Translate. No, Brother Kenny. No. I said, Jorge, trust me. You'll understand it better by and by. I need you to translate. And so with that painful look on his face, he said, okay. Now, being the OCD guy I am, I started over. Not the whole sermon, okay? Don't get nervous. But I started back, Brother Gary, through my waxing eloquent. How can you live the victorious Christian life in a wicked world? You can't. How can you be filled with the Holy Spirit? You can't. How can you please God? You can't. He stayed with me. And then I said, but Christ in you can. And I look back at him, and he is back there grinning from ear to ear. He apologized the rest of the trip. Do you get the point? He did. Took him a while. Are y'all hearing me? You can't be a great soul winner.
She's not my personality. I'm just a shy, backward, introverted.
You can't be a great witness, but Christ in you can. You may not can give that devotion. You may not can give your conversion story. You may not can teach that class. But Christ in you. You want to say the next word? Christ in you can. His resurrection charges my present. I'm 71. I'll turn 72 in a couple of weeks. I came in from Arkansas last night. Came down here today. I'll be at Blue Mountain tomorrow. Somebody says, Brother Kenny, you're fixing to be 72. I've got the resurrected Lord in me. Now, when it gets time for me to go home, I will be glad to. But I'm here to tell you, we have the resurrected Lord. If we're saved now, wait a minute. If you're saved, you have the resurrected Lord living in you. And whatever you face today or whatever you face tomorrow or whatever you face in the middle of tonight, we have the resurrection power of Jesus living in us. His death changed my future. His burial covered my past. His resurrection charges my present. And you don't have to worry about his battery running down. And you don't even have to recharge it. Truly, his resurrection power is not an ever-ready battery, but an everlasting battery. Now listen to me. The gospel changes everything. But hear me. Only the gospel can change everything. Are you hearing me? The only thing that can change our families is the gospel. You got a daughter and son-in-law fixing to get divorced. The gospel's the only thing that can change that. You got a grandson that went off to university and came back an atheist. The gospel is the only thing. You got a granddaughter who now thinks she has gender confusion. You say, you realize who you're talking to? Yeah, I know exactly who I'm talking to. I think most of y'all live in the real world. That homosexual, that transgender person, folks, listen to me. My anger ain't gonna change them. And I tend to get angry. Are y'all with me? Watching that TV show and that girl keeps talking about her wife. My anger's not gonna change anybody. Are y'all listening? My hate ain't gonna change now. The love of God is what it's gonna take. The gospel. The only thing that can change our churches. Do you realize how many of our churches in Mississippi are in danger in 20 years of going belly up? Y'all are so blessed. You've got a good, strong country church. Hallelujah! But we've got churches that are in the critical care unit. It's not just in the Delta. I'm here to tell you, the only thing that's going to change our churches is the gospel. Amen? Our nation's headed to hell in a handbasket. The only thing that's going to change Washington, D.C. is the gospel. The only thing that's going to change our culture. It's not a matter of us being against culture. We just need to get the gospel to our community. There's nothing wrong in a public school that the gospel can't change. But I did a revival in a Christian school this last week, K through 12, and on Monday and Tuesday morning in chapel had 15 children and teenagers had a first time born again experience with Jesus Christ. I'm just telling you, the gospel changes everything. But the gospel is the only thing that can change everything. The gospel can change our world. Iran attacking Israel. I'm here to tell you, that's why we believe in missions. That's why we believe in the Great Commission, because the gospel is the only thing that can change our world. I disagree with some of my preacher brethren. I hear it pretty often. Well, all these redneck Bible conferences I preach in a lot of them because I'm a redneck. But I get tired of hearing it. Only thing is second coming of Jesus.
That's wrong.
You say, you actually believe we can still have revival? It ain't a matter of can we have revival. It's a matter of will we have revival. Will the second coming change everything? Hallelujah! Even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. But if you've settled in to the cynicism that only the second coming can change things, you ought to just go on out and climb up on a hill and wait for Jesus to come back. Amen or oh me? We've got work to do. The gospel can still change everything. One day, when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelled among men. My Redeemer is he. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day, he's coming. Oh, glorious day. You may have walked in here lost. You can walk out of here saved. Because the gospel changes everything. As we stand, as we have our invitations, Brother Gary comes to the altar. Somebody here would just step on out and say, Brother Gary, I need the gospel. I've had religion. I've tried morality. I've tried being a good church member. I've tried putting my best foot forward. I need the gospel. Because if you've never been born again, church member, you need the gospel. The gospel can change everything. If you just be willing to yield. You may be the other person. You're saved. You're happy in Jesus, but that son-in-law isn't. Maybe your spouse isn't. Maybe that granddaughter isn't. Maybe you need to come, just kneel on this altar, call their name, because the gospel can change everything. So whether you need to talk to Brother Gary or whether you just need to come talk to the good Lord, do you know somebody that needs changing? Do you? Do you know somebody that needs changing? They need a change in eternity. Heaven instead of hell. Would you be willing to come call their name in prayer? Then you can get up and go on back to your seat. The gospel changes everything. Come on, right now as we sing. Come on, come on. Come on. Come on, brother. As we sing, come on, right now. Brother Gary's waiting. The altar's available. Anybody need to pray for somebody? Maybe yourself. Maybe a loved one. Will you come right now? So we sing that first verse. Will you come? Brother Gary's waiting. The altar's available. Brother, go ahead and sing that first verse. Who else needs to come pray? Come on.
Savior is waiting.
Who do you need to pray for? The gospel changes everything.
There's nothing in this world.
Do you need to come pray for somebody?
What is your answer?
Time after time, he's waited before. He's waiting right now. Here's your chance to change everything. How about it? While our instrumentalists play softly, I won't drag this out. You've been kind. You've listened. Do you need the gospel? Listen to me. I'm not being negative. I'm not being ugly. We got too many people on Baptist church rolls, mouthed a prayer, walked an aisle, got dunked. But they haven't been born again. Do you need changing? Do you need your future changed? Are you tired of worrying about it? Afraid Jesus will come back tonight and your husband will be gone and your family will be gone and there you are. That's a miserable way to live life. You can walk out of here knowing you're saved. Why? The gospel changes everything. We've had a good group here. I'm not going to drag this out. But is there somebody you need to come pray for? I'm asking you, whether it's yourself, a relative, a friend, whatever. I'm going to ask my brother to sing this next verse by himself. I don't want y'all doing nothing but praying. Any reason you need to come talk to Brother Gary, anybody you need to come call their name in this altar as he sings this next verse by himself, do you need to come right now? Come on, right now. Come on.
If you'll take one step toward the Savior, my friend.
Will you come? One more. You be that one more in 24. How about it?
Receive him and all of your darkness.
Anybody need to pray for somebody?
Within your heart, he'll abide.
Will you come?
Amen. What a blessing has been ours. Thank you, Dr. Digby. I love looking at your Bible. You see, you need to come to the Mississippi Baptist Convention someday. When he gives his report, all you see is that right there. Dr. Digby, thank you for sharing with us the gospel. And the gospel does change everything. Thank you for being here. Dr. Digby and Ms. Becky will be here in the front, so be sure to come by and tell them how much you appreciate them. But as we prepare to go, I'm going to ask Brother Tim, would you close in prayer, please, sir? Tim Buckley, please, sir.